And good morning again. Welcome here. And today is going to be, I think, a interesting and a little bit different session for our Hero Tales. Again, we're going through the book by Theodore Roosevelt and Henry Cabot Lodge, a book of hero tales from American history, true stories, fairly short accounts, selected and composed by Roosevelt and Lodge in order to illustrate to young Americans the principles and the virtues that for them defined what it should mean to be an American. So these hero tales are meant to instruct and inspire. And it's always been an enjoyable book to me. One of the cool things in Hero Tales is the contrasts in some of the stories that are told. And at this point, having started with George Washington and moved through the American Revolution and the War of 1812, and we've seen very different personalities, but most of these hero tales have involved a leader of warriors, leading warriors in battle. The bulk of the hero tales have been about those times when a brave leader needed to use good judgment, physical courage, and initiative to win in a straight-up conflict. And with the exception of Governor Morris, in between the American Revolution and the War of 1812, Roosevelt and Lodge took a break from the military stories to tell the story of a statesman who is exhibiting moral courage, who does not have a large force or even a small force of people backing him up. He doesn't have to inspire men to be brave, but they're not there to rescue him either. He's standing alone in a situation that is not of his own making. Well, today we are again going to shift from the military stories to a very different story. And this chapter of American Hero Tales is John Quincy Adams and the Right of Petition. You see John Q. Adams' image behind me. I'm not inflicting a PowerPoint on you all today because it's a different kind of story. I don't have maps and illustrations for the tactics here. The tactics which are going to be used are all going to be kind of parliamentary tactics. He rests with the immortals. His journey has been long. For him, no wail of sorrow, but a pain full and strong. So well and bravely has he done the work he found to do, to justice, freedom, duty, God and man, forever true. That's the poetic tribute with which they kick off this discussion. And we're going to discuss a part of the life of John Quincy Adams that happens far past the point where you would have thought that, okay, his career is over and he'll hang up his hat. John Quincy Adams, by the time of this story, his presidency is far in the past. And we remember that principle of humility with George Washington and the way that he walked away from political power. John Quincy Adams expresses an idea of duty in a different way by not being ashamed to accept a much lower office than he has before. And that's the setup to our story today. The lot of ex-presidents of the United States, as a rule, has been a life of extreme retirement. But to this rule, there is one marked exception. When John Quincy Adams left the White House in March 1829, it must have seemed as if public life could hold nothing more for him. He had had everything, apparently, that an American statesman could hope for. He had been minister to Holland and Prussia, to Russia and England. He had been a senator of the United States, secretary of state for 8 years, and finally president. Notwithstanding all this, the greatest part of his career and his noblest service to the country were still before him when he gave up the presidency. Well, that next year after he leaves the presidency, John Quincy Adams is asked to run for the House of Representatives as an ordinary congressman with no seniority and only the power of his reputation and his record behind him. And when approached with this, Adams said, "No man can be degraded by serving as a select man of his town if elected thereto by the people." So he believed that the dignity of being an ordinary congressman was quite worthy of a man who had previously been Secretary of State, Senator, and even held the presidency. Now, he moves into Congress at a very contentious, a very contentious time in our history. Soon after Mr. Adams took his seat in Congress, the movement for the abolition of slavery was begun by a few obscure agitators. It's important to set the scene of the conflict to come that the anti-slavery movement is not the overwhelming opinion. It is not a huge and dominant popular force at this time in history. Instead, it's a few, what we would probably classify today as religious extremists, as fanatics, as a special interest group. That's who we're talking about with the agitators, as he puts it. It did not at first attract much attention, but as it went on, it gradually exasperated the overbearing temper of the Southern slaveholders. One fruit of this agitation was the appearance of petitions for the abolition of slavery in the House of Representatives. So one thing that these activists, and it's not a large group of activists, have chosen as a strategy is to place petitions before Congress. And the right of petition, as it's called, is something that John Quincy Adams believes strongly is one of the things that keeps the representatives, the government, accountable to the people. That a group of people can bring a grievance before the legislature and bring it to their attention. That they have the right to bring their complaints to the attention of their representatives. It's important to know through the rest of this story that John Quincy Adams did not say that he was acting as an abolitionist himself. He wasn't so much joining the fight about slavery as he was as an elder statesman. And I noticed that sometimes the older people get, the more there's a sense and an understanding, principles have to be defended. But if I'm going to win my issue that I care about a lot, but only at the cost of damaging free speech, only at the cost of damaging an institution that maybe can't be fixed, that is not worth it. That defending the basic principles is an essential to winning my issue and keeping a free society. You can't throw away one to go for the other. Quick technology check here. I've been having trouble with microphones. Could you all hold up a hand if you can hear me? Can you hear me? Terrific. Thank you. I'm just a little paranoid about that after last time. All right. So these petitions begin to appear before Congress. Petitions sent by a small and very, very loud special interest activist group of the abolitionists. As the petitions multiplied, the Southern representatives became aroused. They assailed Mr. Adams for presenting them. And one after another of these petitions is sent to John Quincy Adams for presentation to Congress. And they finally passed what was known as a gag rule, which prevented the reception of these petitions by the House. So just like the Alien and Sedition Acts, which had been about 30 years earlier, you began to get rules, I'm sorry, closer to 20 years earlier, which are putting a limit on a right. Against this rule, the gag rule, Mr. Adams protested in the midst of loud shouts of the Southerners as a violation of his constitutional right. But the slaveholders undertook in this way to suppress free speech in the House. Certain things were not to be said, not to be brought up, just as they also undertook to prevent transmission through the mails of any writings adverse to slavery. They're trying to control the national conversation, not to win the debate, but to prevent the debate by not allowing your position to be brought up. I think it's a general rule, if you're trying to silence critics instead of inviting them to have their say and refuting them, it just might be because you don't think you can refute them. In any case, John Quincy Adams is going to act boldly, shrewdly, just as we've seen military strategy from commanders of troops in other stories. We're going to see John Quincy Adams using parliamentary rules the way that a good commander uses tactics, or even the way that a good sailor can use the wind to sail against the wind by tacking his ship, the set of the sails. John Quincy Adams can use parliamentary rules to sail against the political winds. He has to be tricky and clever about it, but he manages too. Not only does he have to be tricky and clever, he also has to be a little bit obnoxious. And John Quincy Adams was quite capable of being an obnoxious man. With the wisdom of a statesman and a man of affairs, Mr. Adams addressed himself to the one practical point of the contest. He did not enter upon a discussion of slavery or its abolition, but turned his whole force for the vindication of the right of petition. That if a group of citizens had a concern, they wanted to be heard, that to set a gag rule on this and tell them they couldn't be heard on that issue violated their rights and our constitutional principles. On every petition day, he would offer in constantly increasing numbers petitions which came to him from all parts of the country for the abolition of slavery. In this way, driving the Southern representatives almost to madness, despite their rule, which presented the reception of such documents. So he would stand up and say he had petitions and force them to tell him each time, no, you can't read it. He would stand up with the petition time after time after time. He wouldn't quit, even though he wasn't getting to actually read them. And this built a lot of animosity. Like I said, he was capable of being obnoxious. Their hatred of Mr. Adams is something difficult to conceive, writes Roosevelt and Lodge in the 1890s. Legislative hatred in the 1890s was out of fashion. There are times in American history when it is understandable because a certain amount of legislative hatred is in fashion. Their hatred of Mr. Adams is something difficult to conceive, and they were burning to break him down, and if possible, drive him from the house. Well, this all came to a head with a near riot in February of 1837. Adams stood up on February 6th after presenting the usual petitions. In other words, they're already grinding their teeth. The Democrats are hating this. And then he pushes a little further. After presenting the usual petitions, Mr. Adams offered one upon which he said he should like the judgment of the speaker as to its propriety. This next one, I don't know if it's proper petition or not. Mr. Speaker, this one, the difference is this one is a petition from slaves. They blew their stack. In a moment, the house was in a tumult, and loud cries of "Expel him! Expel him!" rose in all directions. And they began introducing resolutions to throw him out of the House of Representatives. It was not until February 9th, 3 days later, he was able to take the floor in his own defense. Well, this is when the revelation is going to come forward that he drew this attack upon himself with full knowledge of how furious they would get and confident that they would overstep their bounds in order to win his point. His speech was a masterpiece of argument, invective, and sarcasm. He showed, among other things, that he had not offered the petition. So they can't expel him for breaking the gag rule. He hadn't offered the petition. He had asked the advice of the speaker on the petition. And this was his surprise. The petition, supposedly sent and signed by slaves, was a petition against the abolition of slavery. And he said he suspected that the master of the plantation had gotten his slaves to sign this petition asking that slavery not be abolished. But it was actually a pro-slavery petition that he had goaded the opposite party into having a complete breakdown over. When he closed his speech, which was quite as savage as any made against him, and infinitely abler, in other words, he was just as mean and a lot smarter in his expression than those that had been made attacking him, no one desired to reply, and the idea of censuring him was dropped. The issue didn't go away. He had won that skirmish and won it quite handily. And by himself, without a well-disciplined regiment of riflemen, without a ship's company loading cannons and marines firing from the foretop, but much more like that story of Governor Morris standing alone against a mob. John Quincy Adams had won that political skirmish by himself. The greatest struggle, however, came 5 years later when Adams presented a petition of certain citizens of Haverhill, Massachusetts, praying for the dissolution of the Union on account of slavery. So a group of abolitionists has suggested the Union be abolished. You can see these things get complicated. This was 1842. His enemies felt that now at last he had delivered himself into their hands. Again rose the cry for his expulsion. Not because he had said the Union should be dissolved. He didn't. He didn't agree with that. But because he had presented a petition, violating the gag rule. Vituperation poured out upon him, resolutions to expel him freely introduced. When he got to the floor to speak in his own defense, he faced an excited house, almost unanimously hostile to him and possessing, as he well knew, both the will and the power to drive him from its walls. To end his long, distinguished political career in disgrace. There was no wavering. If they say they will try me, he said, they must try me. If they say they will punish me, they must punish me. But if they say that in peace and mercy they will spare me expulsion, I disdain and cast away their mercy and ask if they will come to such a trial and expel me. I defy them. I have constituents to go to, and they will have something to say if this house expels me. Nor will it be long before the gentleman will see me here again. So he's saying, throw me out. We'll go hold an election in my congressional district, and they'll send me back. How about that? The fight went on for nearly a fortnight. On February 7th, the whole subject was finally laid on the table. The sturdy, dogged fighter, single-handed and alone, had beaten all of the forces of slavery. No more memorable fight has ever been made by one man in a parliamentary body. And after this decisive struggle, the tide began to turn. Every year, Mr. Adams renewed his motion to strike out the gag rule and forced it to a vote. Gradually, the majority against it dwindled until at last, on December 3rd, 1844, his motion prevailed. Freedom of speech had been vindicated. So, mixed up with the national argument over slavery, as so many things became mixed up with the national argument over slavery, was a national argument that John Quincy Adams considered more important, more vital, more fundamental. And that was to reassert free speech, the right of the citizens for their concerns to be heard, not simply by electing representatives, because it didn't do them too much good to elect representatives who then were not allowed to talk about the things that citizens themselves were concerned about. John Quincy Adams saw this. His fight for the right of petition is one to be studied and remembered. Mr. Adams made it practically alone. The slaveholders of the South and the representatives of the North were alike against him. Against him, too, was the class in Boston to which he naturally belonged by birth and education. He had to encounter the bitter resistance of his own set. Now, think how in so many of our stories, Roosevelt has praised the tall, grim, sturdy, vigorous frontiersmen and the physical power and strength that these John Wayne characters brought to our nation's battles. But now it's time to praise something different. He was an old man. With the physical infirmities of age, his eyes were weak and streaming. His hands were trembling. His voice cracked in moments of excitement. Yet in that age of oratory, in the days of Webster and Clay, he was known as the old man eloquent. It was what he said, more than the way he said it, which told. His vigorous mind never worked more surely and clearly than when he stood alone in the midst of the House, the target of their hatred and abuse. He had good right to set down in his diary when the gag rule was repealed. Blessed, forever blessed, be the name of God. So John Quincy Adams and the right of petition, a very different American hero tale. But as we remember and take inspiration and see as models those who won battles on land and sea to preserve our nation, we also see somebody fighting a very different kind of battle, but a very important one, to maintain a right that we all must be vigilant for today, to speak speak freely, even on the most contentious issues, and that debate on national questions not be shut down. So thank you all for listening to me today. There's an old joke. I could have made this much shorter, but I didn't prepare enough ahead of time. But in this case, there was just a lot to cover. And I do look forward to next Tuesday morning at 9. Our subject, again, is not a warrior on the battlefield, but rather an artist by the name of Francis Parkman. And so look forward to talking to you all then. If you're interested tomorrow in the subject of commerce raiders, both of the Confederate period and of World War I, then feel free to hop on into our Homeschool Friday schedule for tomorrow. I did go late. Does anybody have any questions? I'll go ahead and stop the recording and take off the mute if anybody'd like to voice some questions or comments now. Stop recording.